Well, that's on an arm.
Now, what do you do to clear everything? On DiamondClub.tv?
What you'll want to do is click on the right one, which is import.
Boop. That?
Yeah. And then just click import, which is blank.
Ah.
And then you'll do the...
Add new
random,
item.
The random order, because the add new item won't work.
Oh.
Now add new item.
Aha. Not exactly insanely user friendly, but.
No, but you can get there if you know.
Yeah. Boop, boot, doodle, 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 doo. We're checking if we are live.
Hello.
Uh oh, that looks like Daily Motion. Want to skip this ad? Press this thing called Skip It, which is probably another advertising service.
While you're skipping this ad, check this other question out.
Exhilarating. Meat impeccable.
You know what? I do like candy. I'm gonna go find
some. Go find some candy. Please find candy now. Oh crap.
Uh-oh.
We live. Click. Alright. Now where do I find that there? Chat room. I guess I could just run with the IRC. DiamondClub.tv. You are one with BDD. Oh, just. That's fine. Good. Pop that out. Connect. My neck, my back, lick my pussy and my crack. Oh, is that where that is? So I'll have to drag. I'll drag Andrew up there.
Jackie, don't panic. I found candy. I found candy.
Ooh, that sounds so good.
This is probably just my hot.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, look at that.
How is, did anyone tell anyone that we're here, or do people just leave their browser open?
No, people just hang. People just kick it. Yeah, folks, this is going to be Weird Things. We're going to do a Weird Things in Brian's house without Brian. Brian's voice is, to say mildly, a big fat bag of shitholes. So he has to rest it because he has to do other things that bring him in money, like recording stand-ups for Scam School and blowing strangers. Andrew will call us. We will have him on Skype. And then we will all cry together.
Great big dragon tears.
Great big tears of joy.
Is this mic on?
Is it?
Talking to it? I am talking.
Check, check, check.
Breaker, breaker, 1-9er. Nope.
Hello? Okay.
So which is that? Blue cord. Surfboard. Gosh darn it. Right here.
Check, check, check.
Breaker, breaker.
Breaker, breaker, 1-9er. What's your 20 over?
Keep talking.
Traffic on the 105 today is looking particularly crappy.
I'm right over here, guys. Can you hear me now?
Hey. Oh, baby.
That sounds like a pile of AIDS. Okay. Surfboard.
I just ate 30 alligators. Check. Checking on alligator meat. Yep. We're good.
So, Brett, you came to South by Southwest. You feel like you've learned more about the state of technology?
Oh, absolutely. One of the panels I was in today, I was served a bloomin' onion.
Uh-huh.
And what impressed me most,
yeah,
about this new technological advancement,
sure,
the blooming onion.
The blooming onion.
Was just how crunchy you can make grease nowadays.
Mmm.
I was always under the impression that grease had to be more or less a liquid.
Yeah.
But as it turns out, in this brave new world we're living in, you can make it very crunchy and add a little bit of dipping sauce.
Yeah.
And suddenly you get to call it food.
It sounds like you were at Outback.
No, South by.
Outback.
I'm in Austin.
Surfport. Outback.
South by.
South by Outback.
Austin, Texas.
Outback, Austin.
I don't think that you can be in Austin during South by and not call everything you go to a panel.
That's a fair point.
So I was at a panel today. Legitimate point. For sure.
Do you think that at your panel,
yeah,
you had to pay at the end to a lady that got you tea?
At South by?
At South by.
Afternoon. I did. I mean, I thought that was weird, but I feel like obviously if that's the way technology is going,
mm-hmm,
then I mean, you have to be part of the team or not part of the experience at all, right?
Listen, like, I'm not going to tell you you're an idiot.
Mm-hmm.
I'll let life do that.
Uh-huh.
But you need to get your head out of the suction of your asshole.
That sounded like you called me an idiot. You just used a lot more words to get there.
No, it's a South by thing.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, then I trust it because I'm part of the team.
South by Southwest. We're waiting for Andrew, ladies and gentlemen. This is what we like to call a part of the show. Brian's not here to do all sorts of fancy fiddling tricks. And I am waiting for Andrew to be ready to go.
Also, I didn't buy a badge, so I felt like it was fair to charge me at the end of the panel. Piecemeal style. Emphasis on the word meal.
Because that's what you were eating. Instead, I'm going to just silently play the Golden Girls on repeat.
Silently?
Yeah, it's muted.
Why?
So it's just going to be just us talking while the Golden Girls theme song plays over and over again.
Unbeknownst to literally anyone.
Well, and also it's weird that we're not looking at each other. Like, we can see each other in the monitor, but
I'm
like
looking
we're just,
at you.
We're just doing avant-garde art.
Wanna, there,
number one,
better,
I'm going to say something.
That's a better framing.
I'm going to say something that I feel like we've all said at one point in our life. What the fuck is with this Golden Girl video? I'm going to refresh that.
I would guess that at least 1,932,614 people have said that.
Here we go. Party's about to start, ladies and gentlemen.
With a silent Golden Girls theme song video.
Yeah. Now we're ready to roll. All right, so Brett, what's going on? What do you think about society?
Is it true that like not even the viewers can hear the Golden Girls theme song right
no,
now?
No, nobody can hear it. It's just
not
gonna,
a single
no.
person.
So we really, saw Alex Jones at a laser tag.
Oh, we did.
See, now we've been talking a bunch of mad bullshit before, uh-huh, and now people aren't going to know whether or not we're telling the truth. But this actually happened. We were at a laser tag, and we saw Alex Jones, and we said hi, and he said he liked my shirt.
True story.
And if you don't fucking believe that, then believe Estelle Getty and the rest of the Golden Girls, whose theme song is going to begin playing again right now.
Silently.
I like to think of this as like we can measure our conversations in Golden Girls theme song plays.
Oh yeah, so like That's kind of neat. It's like a power hour of Golden Girls about different topics. So every 41 seconds, we have to change topics, not because anyone says so much as because that's how long the Golden Girls theme song is.
Yeah. The 365 nerd, when's Brian going to get his internal network shit figured out, or am I the dick lagging? Number one, dick lagging would be a great senator's name. Elect Dick Lagging, U.S. Senate.
And that's actually my Iggy Pop cover
we're
band.
We're back. I don't think that we are lagging. It doesn't look like we are lagging on our end. So it might be you, Dick Lagging. Dude, there was seriously Alex Jones there. Like, I feel like we're downplaying the fact that we all saw Alex Jones. And he wished me a good one. Because he was leaving while me and Ashley were outside because she was trying to cool down for playing Dance Dance Revolution. And he looked over at me and said, hey, have a good one.
God bless America.
He did. He said God bless a lot.
Yeah.
He was definitely throwing a lot of God blesses.
He threw a lot of punches, too, which I thought was a weird choice to do.
Here's the thing. This is such a weird story that you can't, like, you can't embellish it.
I feel like you're right, but it's
like
one of those
Alex
weird
Jones
stories.
Was really polite to us at a laser tag arena. Like, there really is not a whole lot funnier than that.
You know what's really bizarre is, so I was in the other car from you when we were driving over there with Bonnie and Brian, and we were talking about Alex Jones on the way to laser tag. And so when we got there, and you were like, holy shit, don't look behind you, but I think that's Alex Jones.
You're yeah.
Like, that's really funny, Jerry, that you would say that, but I'm not believing. Oh my God, Alex Jones is standing behind me.
Yeah. So Kyo says, what am I able to see here? I'm able to see that. Mega Vortex Jerry, you should have told him, thank you for being a friend. And if he had a party and invited everyone he knew, you would see the biggest gift would be from me. And the card attached would say, 1776 will commence again. Infinite Looper. Oh, that would be a good thing. Infinitelooper.com. We can just automate this Golden Girls shit.
Because this is a really important part of this process, is making sure that we have an infinite loop of the Golden Girls theme song. Not playing, mind you.
Ooh, loop YouTube videos. We're again waiting for Andrew Main.
I think I used to have hair right there.
Yeah, now you're balding.
It's a shame.
There we go.
Oh, that's kind of rad. You can choose what part it loops at. Look at you, clever internet.
Oh, look, other things. We can loop Blossom. Let's go ahead and loop Blossom season 2.
Well, now you're just being silly. Also silently.
Dude, Blossom was the shit back in the day.
You know she's like an actual neuroscientist?
Yeah, right? Didn't she like, because like now she's on the Big Bang Theory, but like she took off a bunch of time to actually like do a bunch of other stuff, right?
Yeah. Did you see there was like a clip of her on a red carpet somewhere or something where the lady was like, well, I mean, I know you're not a genius like your character or whatever. And she's like, I'm a neuroscientist. And just like mad dog the reporter.
Really?
Lady. Yeah.
That is like pretty weird. Like it's just that it's odd that somebody would be especially if, like, for her, she was a lady who was just like a really successful actress that was kind of tapped to be somebody that have a career for a long time and just be like, yeah, you know, like pretty rad. Also, let me like study the brain because I'm really into that.
Yeah. Also, I'm really into hats and flowers.
I mean, her name was Blossom, right?
Yeah.
Like, so that makes sense.
This is such a bizarre... This is, I feel like, a fever dream. The fact that it's silent is only making me more sick to my stomach while watching this.
She's got the moves, though. Look at that. Even without the rhythm.
It's like, creeping me out. Like, if she had a little bit of face paint on, there is no doubt that this would haunt my nightmares for weeks on end. That
what,
alone
what kind
right
of face paint?
Like, anything white. Like, something that shouldn't be there. Like, a kind of like a clown.
Yeah. Also, just go ahead and compare this video to any actual time you've spent with Jenny Gottstein, and you will realize it's the exact same thing.
Yes, that's that. You just blew my mind.
That we work with Blossom.
Yeah,
that's and more specifically crazy. The Blossom intro.
The human Blossom intro, Jenny Gottstein.
She can travel the world.
Oh, that's so weird. This is literally like, hey guys, where have you been? I just got back from a...
Where are you going, buddy? Where are you going?
Nowhere good. Oh, nowhere, man. You should go.
The other funny thing about it is that it's like probably not nice to say in public, and also no one would get it.
Yeah.
I would get it. True. Maybe Ashley would get it. Other than that, nobody. Unless, of course, it got back to her. And that would only be because I told everybody to tweet at... I'm just kidding.
I actually feel like it has a good chance of getting back to her in that she apparently knows and hangs out with everyone on the planet.
Oh, and she'd be like, oh, like me am? Oh, no, we've talked about that all the time.
Yeah.
I do the dance like this. And then she'd do the dance because that's the kind of person she is. All right, everybody. We are going to talk about weird things today. I don't know how much prep Andrew has done. There is plenty of stuff to talk about. And I'm going to go ahead and list today's episode at about an 80% likelihood of us talking crap about Neil deGrasse Tyson. Hello, Mr. Maine. You go ahead and call NSFW Show 2. I am already live online with Brett. We are waiting for you, and then we're ready to go.
That's just NSFW Show.
Oh, no, sorry. No, call NSFW Show. That's the one that's up here now. Boy. Oh, Blossom. We're going to have to let you go. Andrew's calling.
Oh, that's so weird. It's like her whole body is double jointed. And also she's wearing her fat grandpa's sweater.
Andrew?
Also wearing his fat grandpa's sweater.
Where do you think this comes from?
Sound?
Sound. Oh, nope. Sun is gonna surely shine. That's not appropriate. Andrew, can you talk here? We're still trying to figure out Brian's board.
Hi.
Oh, there we go.
Hello.
Magic. Yeah. Hi, Andrew. I missed your smiling face.
Fuck you, Brett.
What?
Hey, language.
What did you think I said? I said I love you, Brett.
Oh.
Oh, language?
My ears.
So if I just hit record, that will just record everything that's going on?
Yeah, that'll record the output to the stream.
Okay.
Everything you're putting out, that is what it'll record.
Andrew's face has become rubber. There we go. Awesome. Well, I think we are ready to roll. I will defer to you, Andrew. I'm going to hit record right now.
All
right,
are we live?
We are live. Let's go ahead and tweet it out.
Oh, I don't have my phone.
We are going to be, we are currently on diamondclub.tv.
I think this is the microphone that Veronica spit all over last night. Not sure I should be eating it. Well, there are probably other reasons why I shouldn't be eating the microphone.
Yeah, he's cutting in and out on me.
I'm cutting in and out on you?
A damn track was.
Oh.
Only me? Is this microphone?
No, sounds better now, maybe.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, it was actually, we were getting a little audio doubling on your end, but I think it's filtered out.
Sure, blame me.
I mean, I'm not.
Entirely.
So who among us has seen Grand Budapest Hotel?
I'm going to assume it's one out of three. And because I believe it is only released in New York and LA this week.
So oh, really?
Even if we wanted to, we would not have been able to see it here in Austin.
Oh, that's weird. You'd think they'd release it here this weekend.
Well, I mean, I'm sure, like, I don't know. The Veronica Mars movie apparently premiered and got good reviews, which I'm very happy about.
Oh, yeah.
The review I read today was that it's good. It certainly stays true to the show. Pretty much to the point where you got to wonder if anybody who didn't see the show, which was a fairly minuscule audience, will give a rat's butt.
Well, really, they're thinking of everything they put out to the theater as just bonus points, right?
No. I think like they would like to continue to make it a franchise of films, and that will be dependent on whether or not it does well.
What I was reading about is basically they've already made their money back on the show, and they are counting on people buying the streaming DVDs or the digital copies because it's going out the same day.
Oh,
the digital copies already out, and they aren't even making, they aren't even using the same cuts with like AMC and Regal as they normally would. Instead, they're literally renting out the theater.
Oh, interesting.
And so they're taking the entirety of what the movie makes minus the rental fees.
Cool. Is there a way for me to get your video?
Oh, yeah.
Brian does it.
Did that work?
Whoa.
Like something's happening.
Your head is giant. Now it's normal sized. Maybe a little small. It's weird.
Are we sending video yet?
Not yet.
All right. How about now?
No, that'd be negative.
Profile. Nah, man. I do not know. Brian, do you know what this capture would be?
Nope.
Crap town fart.
Brian can do it. Brian can always do it. Brian.
Listen, Brian.
I'm saying, Brian makes it work.
Really?
I mean, he may have to restart the system 9 times, but...
That is a thing that he also likes to do.
Your video is definitely turned off right now. So regardless of whether or not you fix it,
it says it
won't show.
It can't...
I think the webcam options are under tools.
Tools.
Yeah. Yes, tools. I'm speaking to at least
options.
One.
Options.
Zing! What? Wait, which one?
Don't worry about it.
No.
So I'll say this about Grand Budapest Hotel. In the pantheon of Anderson, certainly not the best.
Uh-huh.
But Ralph Fiennes is just fantastic.
Kind of born for that material, right?
Yeah, he turns in, I think, probably one of the best performances you've ever seen in one of those films. His character is just so, you know, wonderful. And I'm thinking like, man, he is so great at comedy, and I can never think of him having done one before.
Yeah.
Show me a picture of Ralph Fiennes.
Voldemort.
Show me a picture of Ralph Fiennes.
Us just screaming Voldemort, is that enough for you? Andrew, I really do not know how I'm going to solve this video thing. Is there any way that we can roll without the video coming back?
That's fine, as long as there's video going out to the people.
There is video going out to the people.
Oh, I'll just click on that feed.
Probably be laggy.
I just want to watch your pretty faces.
Mm-hmm.
In that case.
Refines.
All right.
Oh, why didn't you say so?
There's the Rafe.
I thought it was Ralph.
I've always
heard an Office Rafe. Depot ad. I spent all day there yesterday.
Okay.
Guy behind the counter goes, "So where's Justin?" I'm like,
wait,
real? I get you know, like the day before I get stopped on the street. Some people had seen the show, but then the next day it's, oh yeah, you do podcasts and stuff. I do a TV show. Really? Never mind. Never mind. Doesn't matter.
Have I launched virtual camera and Wirecast? No.
Output. Virtual camera out.
All right.
All right.
I'm good to go.
Are you?
I mean, right. I'm saying whenever you're ready.
I'm gonna start. I'm gonna try. I think I might have figured out one more thing. Output virtual camera start. Okay, hold on. Wait a minute. Goodness gracious, boogity B. Options, video.
So I tried to beat my pull-up record.
Uh-huh.
And then I forgot that I tried to beat my pull-up record until like 2 days later, I got mysterious pains all over my shoulder area. And I'm like, what happened? I'm like, what? I can't think of why. I'm like, oh yeah. Because I did it like 2 a.m. one night. Because I have a chin.
It's always the best time.
I'm like, God, let me do this. I'm like, I was so proud of myself. And then I went to sleep and forgot. And 2 days later, I'm like these mysterious, I'm like, am I in a fight club and I don't know it?
I did yoga once for like an hour one day, and a week later I could barely walk.
Yeah, I guess that was this, because like, and I do pull-ups all the time, but I just tried to push it, and I think I got to the point where I exhausted other muscles, and then minor ones came in.
Yeah. What is your pull-up record?
Oh, like just doing like straight up, like flat, like not like do full as like 10.
Mm-hmm.
But
all right, I'm gonna start the recording, and then you get ready to roll. All right, Andrew.
Ready to go.
And go.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Weird Things podcast. We've replaced Brian Brushwood forever.
Take that, Brian.
Yeah, well, for the length of this podcast, which can feel like forever. So that voice you hear is Mr. Brett Runceville.
It's close.
How would I say your name if I wanted to say it right?
It's pronounced Brett Runceville. No, Brett Runceville, but I mean, Runceville. I don't use my last name for anything.
I've known you as Amtrekker for like a billion years.
That's
so
fine too.
It's always confusing. And then joining us, of course, is Mr. Jason Yang.
Yeah, I pronounce my name Steak Frites. It's my rap name. Brian is. We're actually recording in Brian's studio. Me and Brett are in Austin, Texas, in Brian's studio. Brian, unfortunately, between doing a gig on Friday and we had the DiamondClub.tv meetup/concert yesterday here at South By, has completely ragged out his voice and is now sleeping/not talking. So we are going to do the show anyway because we got to give the people what they want, and that is Weird Things, Hell or High Water. And that means that we're doing a show without Brian in Brian's house.
Fair enough.
With added Brett.
With added Brett. Also, Brett's here because whatever.
Yeah, exactly. Gentlemen, you know, this has been another great week filled with really cool, weird thing type news. And one of the things that caught my eye, and this is a thing we've talked about before. We've mentioned before the idea of, there's a thing called the Fermi paradox. And basically the idea is that if there's intelligent life out there and the universe is billions of years old, why haven't we seen said intelligent life? Wouldn't they have visited here? Wouldn't they have been building colonies all around the universe? And there are a lot of answers to that. You know, one is that makes the assumption that they would want to go beyond their planet and, you know, create this galaxy-wide civilization, which is a big, you know, assumption that assumes, too, that they would come here and molest us, metaphorically speaking, or maybe literally, as some people claim. And three, it assumes that we would see their handiwork. And we've talked about in a previous podcast about how there's really awesome brain-melting computing technology where instead of, you know, just using more and more resources, you start messing with the physical laws of the universe and building computers that get smaller and smaller and smaller to the point that you could put, you know, in a near infinity of computers inside of an atom, whatever. Anyhow.
Yeah.
Now comes another cool idea, which further, you know, complicates the idea of why we haven't seen anybody. And some scientists have been talking about a way to make things very, very energy efficient and to capture all the available energy that would come towards a planet. And they point out that we give off 100 millions of gigawatts of energy into space at any given moment.
Great Scott!
Yeah, 100 million gigawatts, yes.
Gigawatts.
And so basically, if you look at the Earth on an infrared camera, you would see all this energy radiating back out. And the scientists said, well, there's a way that we think now, theoretically, we could build collectors that would collect this energy too. And so the effectively what we'd do is you'd have a whole other source of energy.
Oh, wow. So we could recycle our own the own energy that we give out into the universe.
Yeah, the reflected energy, the light that comes from the sun that then would get bounced off, how to capture all of that, all the heat energy, et cetera. And it would be a tremendous source of energy. And if you reached your maximum limit with that, you could cover your entire planet with this material. And it would also have a side effect.
Uh-huh.
Your planet would be invisible.
What?
Bum, bum, bum.
It's essentially how to make a stealth planet.
So the way that you would, if you were an alien civilization and you were looking for other planets, like so, but we are to somebody else an alien civilization looking for their planets, the way that we would find them is based on the energy signature that they give off. And if mm-hmm. we were able to dampen that, we are essentially putting on the Harry Potter invisibility cloak as we make our way to Zonko's joke shop.
Precisely. Okay. I think that was actually the example they used in the paper. So that's what would be a side effect. We've talked about, like we mentioned, P-cell previously, which is the cellular technology.
Yes.
Which would be super directed, which would be very efficient. And then now you have this form of energy thing that now that there could be tons of stealth planets out there. Now, we just did a survey, by the way, of the area around our solar system trying to see if there might be a rogue planet.
Yeah.
And we were looking for, we could spot something that was like Neptune-sized or bigger, Saturn-sized or bigger at one distance, Neptune-sized or bigger at a certain distance, and all the way out to like the Oort cloud. And so far, we haven't found anything. But if it were a stealth planet, we wouldn't know. And if it were much smaller than that, like Mars-sized, would still be out there.
So
within our own solar system?
I mean, and if you were to look
in the outer limits, yeah.
If you were to look at this from a either-or perspective, that would you completely revolutionize how we think of energy on Earth at the cost of making ourselves invisible to anybody who would want to find us? That's a no-brainer, right? Like, we would take the energy instead of the calling card to the rest of the universe that we are here.
Perhaps. I think that if you reached a certain level of technology and you're seeking energy, you know, efficiency, and second, maybe you are paranoid about, listen, you know, like, hey, we made this and maybe we know there are other people out there. Maybe you do pick up stray radio signals. If a couple other civilizations pick them up from other ones, like, man, you know, these people are 100 light years away and, you know, they're watching I Love Lucy right now, which means they're 100 years more advanced. You know, their own version of that, you know, you could have two civilizations that were close to each other, you know, that within radio distance that would then say, okay, what do we want to do? Do we want to hide our presence?
Yeah.
You know, or do we announce our presence? And that's the thing to think about is what happens if we see something and then it disappears as if they decided to hide themselves.
Are you sure you weren't just reading Pandora's Star?
Well, it's you know, it's funny as we talk, as I say this out loud, that just came to my mind too.
Yeah.
Was the similarities between that. You know, we've got 20 light years away. We've got, I think it's Gliese is a star system or there are planets that we know that there are planets around. There are multiple planets. There's actually a planet 4.5 light years away. But there's, you know, another planet system where we could have stuff that might be Earth sized or whatever. And, you know, how freaky would that be if all of a sudden we're like, you know what? We can't see this planet anymore.
Yeah.
So, all right, let's assume that we are in a place where we can do more with that information. You know, let's say we have long range space transport and now we look at the things around us in our universe far more like we look at other countries in terms of their ability to do harm to us and our ability to do harm to them. Is that an act of war? I mean, like, imagine if a country was just, you know, completely off the grid and we couldn't find out exactly where it was, you know, to go after. Like, is that an act of aggression to take that kind of cloaking maneuver?
No, if anything, that's an act of defense.
I wouldn't necessarily read
right?
it as that because if in the history of animals and the evolution in biology, an animal that cloaks itself is often trying to avoid being being preyed upon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that'd be hard. It'd be hard. I'm just saying, if we just had our current technology and we're doing some sort of laser scan thing and we see the signs of like there's something here, then now it looks like it's gone and we just got a fragment of a radio transmission, you know, that would be kind of spooky.
Oh, it's insane. I mean, like the it would capture the imagination of the world, right?
So, yeah, that being said, I mean, we don't have anything that captures an entire world's imagination quite like that. Do you think that that moment where that planet disappears and we have easy proof that this planet just wiped itself off the face of the universe as far as we know, do you think that that would spark just this mad technological gold rush to try and find a way to communicate with this planet?
Well, that perhaps, but that brings up the question, Brett. Do we say if we think that, you know, we think there's evidence that they decided to shield themselves or hide themselves, do we take that as evidence that, like, they don't want to talk to us?
Right. But, I mean, how do you tamp down that innate human curiosity to not want to poke it with a stick when it disappears? That's like a little kid with a chameleon throwing it around on all these plaid fabrics just to see what happens.
I mean, we would certainly try to find other ways to identify it, right? I mean, if the way that we have figured out how to see if something is there fails, we would try other ways of doing it.
Mm-hmm. I think if we started to see other ways, it's hard because it comes down to once the you can't see it, you might be able to try to pick up some sort of gravity signatures as it orbits its star. You look for that. You know, if it's a complex system, it becomes harder with a lot of different planets. And if you then sort of see, yeah, we think there's something there, but they're not letting us see it. And the only there's a body there. The only thing we can explain is that it's been cloaked, so to speak. Do you then say, let's send a probe out there?
I mean, right now, Mars is the object of the world's fascination in terms of, you know, planets. It is within a certain degree colonizable. It is part of our folklore. It is a very large target for space exploration. If something like this occurs, you got to figure it is something that we want to figure out. You know, it is maybe the biggest mystery that we would have seen in terms of like an active, like active space problems don't really pop up in our modern world. And that would be,
well,
one.
If we look for corollaries, when they had the last big typhoon to hit Southeast Asia, one of the regions that we were very concerned about, or rescuers are concerned about, is there was a bunch of little islands there. And on the islands is one of the last totally isolated groups of people. This is a tribe that, to our knowledge, has never had first contact with Western civilization.
Yeah.
They've had contact with tribes that then have had contact with people outside, but these people directly have never had contact with us. And when we sent our helicopters by to go check on them, they ran out of the beach with their spears and threw them at the helicopters.
Yes.
It's our attitude towards these people is, hey, hands off, just leave them be. Now, we could argue from an individualist point of view how, you know, if you're the inbred offspring of said tribal member and subject to the whatever sort of primitive lifestyle they have, which can involve all sorts of horrific acts, maybe that's not the wisest choice. But our policy as a whole is hands off on these folks.
Yeah.
I feel like we missed a chance with the Mars talk a second ago. Like, I feel like that's a great analogy to throw this blanket over the top of. What if, like, tomorrow Mars disappeared and we don't know why? Are we saying that we wouldn't do everything we can to go out there and try and figure out why Mars went stealth all of a sudden?
Then we go into the militarization as fast as we can.
Well, but then that goes back to my first thing. Like if all of a sudden it goes dark, then that's a reason. I mean, if it's not an act of war by whatever leadership we would assume runs Mars, it is certainly a reason for us to, you know, start polishing off the you know, anything that we can to defend ourselves against something.
Sure. Build up a strong defense, but that's different than, do we want to send probes out there? Do we want to go into their space and their you know, go into their solar system and start? And granted, you know,
because if I'm the president, I'm just launching nukes, and I know that they probably straight don't get at Mars. There. I'm just saying, I'm calling up Elon, and I'm like, dude, you heard this Mars stuff? And he's like, bro, I did. And I'm like, how many nukes can we get on a rocket to hit Mars tomorrow?
Are you kidding me? Right now, you like Mars disappears, and you're like the president of the Intergalactic Federation. You
I'm
just shoot missiles
Earth.
At it.
Yes. I'm president of the United States.
And, it's camouflage.
You're like, I'm Justin. I send nukes.
Camouflage should be used for offensive or defensive. And there's actually another precedent to this too. Like Japan in the 19th century, they decided to seal off their borders to all Westerners.
Oh yeah.
And you know, they said, we don't want to trade. And then Admiral Perry, played by John Wayne in the movie, showed up with a fleet of ships and was like, hey, open up your ports. We want to trade. And
oh man.
And how'd that end?
You can see The Last Samurai starring Tom Cruise.
But that's the move, right? But, like, isn't diplomacy still the first move? You just like send, you like tomorrow we could drop someone in a rocket and send them to Mars. Like, it's not necessarily going to be safe, right? They might not make it alive, but that's probably what we do if Mars disappears, right?
Yeah, all right. So like that's going to be like, hey, we're going to send you, Brett, behind enemy lines in Russia. But, you know, we're going to give you asthma. We're going to give you no food supply. You know,
what's
you
Martian for suit. Don't kill the messenger?
Yeah. All right. All right. One more thing on this, and then we can move on to another topic. Let's follow this idea. Mars disappears. Okay. Beyond what we would do in terms of a defensive buildup, what is even our best guess on who is making that call if it's an intelligent entity, and you know, the idea that maybe it's some sort of natural phenomenon that we just have not seen until now?
I mean, what happens is you'd have your world governments, and then each politician, ours and everybody else, would pick their favorite scientists and put them into a room, and then they would sort of argue for some sort of consensus on what they think is happening.
Yeah.
And you know, they would quickly fall behind a couple theories that they think best supports what they support and what they can deal with. Whether or not that's going to be the reality of what happened, you know, isn't necessarily the case. And that's often what happens when you get big, you know, government scientific inquiries. You know, you're told we need an answer now, so you give them an answer. But sometimes that answer is not going to be the one that you need, because there's the information you need is unavailable. So we'll have an explanation. Will it be the right one?
Man.
Will it be the one that results in Justin sending nukes to Mars?
I'm just saying. Boom, 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 boom. Alpha Tango Zulu Foxtrot to Mars.
That's
boom.
Such a terrible idea. I like, so, there's so many reasons
I'm
why that's a terrible
idea. I'm cracking those
codes,
bro. And they're all going to the red planet. Yeah. You think you can hide from me? I don't think so. Welcome to President Young's administration.
We have the power to destroy almost 100 square miles of Mars. And then, of course, they still have plenty of room to retaliate. And they're also, by the way, capable of making an entire planet disappear.
Oh, that.
So, the it was on a Google Hangout with some fellow members of Diamond Club.
Mm-hmm.
And a subject came up. Somebody asked, we were talking to somebody from Michigan and asked, you know, what's interesting in Michigan? Do you have any paranormal stuff or whatever there? And he replied, no, said, no, they did not. And I was curious, or excuse me, Wisconsin, pardon me. And I said, oh, that's interesting. I wonder. And so I looked up Wisconsin to find out what kind of mythical animals or legends they have there. And I found one of the most awesome ones I've ever heard before.
Okay.
And I want to, it's not just an animal, not just a mythical creature or some sort of, you know, weird creature. It's like a whole, like there's a town, and I'm trying to find it out. It's called Haunchyville.
Oh,
have you heard of Haunchyville?
I've never heard of Haunchyville, Wisconsin. No,
I've heard of Haunchy Tonks. That's where they do the rock and roll
get
country
back,
music, right?
Haunchy Cat, you better get back in the woods.
Located near Mystic Drive in Muskego, Wisconsin.
Okay.
Haunchyville is a mythical village of dwarfs in
what?
Waukesha County, Wisconsin. Locals say that within the woods near Muskego, Wisconsin, lives a conclave of dwarves whose homes are built to scale and in the woods. In the mythical village is said to live an old albino man who serves as their protector. Legend has it, if trespassers are caught, the unruly dwarves cut their legs from their knees down so they're forced to live like one of them. According to the legend, within the woods, excuse me, Katrina Legend, after the continuous exploitation of a number of circus dwarfs, they revolted against the ringleader. After killing their master, they hanged him in a wooded area after first cutting off his arms and legs. To avoid being arrested or even worse consequences from the circus community, the dwarfs set out to create their own community built exclusively for dwarfs.
This sounds like an easily explored myth.
Well, I mean, it's not crazy, though. I mean, like, you have towns. Like, what's the town in Florida where all the freaks live?
Well, there's Bridgeport in Connecticut.
Davy.
No, Davy, of course. No. No, but there's one. It's in the west coast of Florida, and I can't remember what it...
Barnum and Bailey used to, like, summer in Bridgeport, Connecticut. That was a town that was started, specifically for the circus.
Yeah, no, there's another one in Florida where it's, like, they've had, like, reality shows there or whatever that is comprised by, you know, people who are otherwise full-time traveling in circuses and stuff like that. And,
yeah, that was where they would winter. I could think of it. Gibsonton.
Gibsonton, that's it. Or Gobsonton. It's something like that.
Gibbstown.
Gibbstown, that's it. So, I mean, like, that's really not, I mean, of course, we're taking away the murder element of this and the strange albino man who will cut off your arms and legs, but...
No, just your legs, so you're short.
Oh, like just your legs, so you can have...
Oh, no, arms, too. I'm sorry, my bad.
Yeah, because otherwise you'd have a really unfair advantage in pickup basketball if you were, like, short, but you had this crazy wingspan.
You think that gives you an advantage? You have no knees, but you have long arms?
I'm just saying. You can put your arms up. You're blocking shots. You're like the Hakeem Olajuwon. You're
falling on your face repeatedly.
Oh, dude. So obviously that part is something that is far-fetched, right?
Well, but the
idea
that
a bunch
of
circus dwarves would live in a town in Wisconsin, like, is that unreasonable to think?
I don't think so. And in fact, I would even say that it's not super unreasonable that there is, like, enough mayhem for there to be a growing myth of mayhem. Just because, I mean, like, the rules were way laxer, one, in that era, and two, in circuses specifically. Those things were, like, rife with all kinds of shady shenanigans back in the day.
Oh, yeah. I mean... Like so what do we know a time period on when the origins of this were said to come to be, Andrew?
It's not the most well documented, but according to one article, it says there were a lot of circus enclaves in Wisconsin, and when those circuses broke up, they had a lot of little people that had to go somewhere. So it's not entirely impossible to think that at one point, and I'm gonna get to something in a second, but you know, there could have been a little village of just, you know, that some trailers or whatever, some dwarf people had set up there for, like, a winter or two.
And I mean, and then once you get there, how far is it to get to the, like, well, maybe some really brutal, horrific stuff happened there at some point, and then it had this reputation forever?
Yeah.
Yeah, and you don't even have to get the really brutal stuff. I mean, if you have a bunch of kids who see these dwarfs, they're going to come up with the most messed up, screwed up thing they can come up with. Now, as a side note, you may remember when we first discussed the legend of Monkey Island, and your intrepid explorer here decided to take it upon himself to find the remnants of this lost simian civilization in the heart of Los Angeles.
Also known as to stop on his way to the Togo sandwich shop, because the office he was working in was right next to where Monkey Island was supposed to be.
Yes, and I did find remnants of Monkey Island.
You did.
I found concrete structures, embankments, part of it, which would tie back into this wonderful civilization. Well, this wonderful theme park attraction that was probably a horrific place for monkeys to live. But anyhow, having got to the bottom of that, I decided to embark upon an investigation for Haunchyville.
Really?
But I decided I'd just do it from the comfort of my own place here on computer. Using Google Images on Google Earth.
There we go.
I did a search of the swampland or the area of the land around that part of Wisconsin.
Okay.
Basically going over by, you know, several yards by several yards, trying to find any remnants of it. And I could find no present remnants of Haunchyville. But that's not to say there wasn't things there, which would maybe require some sort of on-the-foot investigation.
We do have people in the chat room that are from Wisconsin that are volunteering to go physically investigate Haunchyville. If you would like to do that, then please go ahead and hit us up on Twitter. We'll coordinate going out there and asking around, because I think that would be really, really fun.
It sounded like you had pretty good coordinates on where Haunchyville was Is that not true? Like, you know, it's basically like west of X City.
The road, they say that near this road, they it's, you know, they're pretty specific about.
Huh. See, that's the thing where, like, how do you build a myth about a city when you tell the people where the city is and there's not something there?
It's in woods, Brett.
On a road? Like, I live in the woods on a road. I could still tell you how to get to my house.
But the road ends and then it ends in woods. So, like, down in South Florida, there are parts of South Florida. Like, you look and you see Miami. If you then go west, you're not necessarily right in the Everglades just yet. It gets to be in the sticks. And there are places out there that, like, you know, up until recently, even some places, you know, if you drive down there, you get shot at, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There, way out in there was, you know, that was used to be back in the 30s, was in the 20s and 30s, like Al Capone had a house out there, like, and he would, like, a gambling house, and they would feed people to alligators and stuff. And so you knew that was out there, but you didn't go there.
Yeah.
And this could be that. And also, I mean, like, let's even take it beyond any kind of, you know, the physical attributes of the people there. Like, the idea of the circus or traveling performer, like, was, I mean, talk about, like, cloaking a planet. In a pre-internet and pre-mass communication age, you were essentially an anonymous person, right? I mean, like, so much of the life you would build would be your physical reputation amongst people that knew who you were and what you did and the sum total of your actions as they could remember them. If you just travel from town to town, I mean, it is anonymity to the extreme, right?
Well, until you're a dwarf and someone paints that broad brush on every dwarf that they see after hearing a story about you cutting off people's legs.
Well, but even then, who hears, like, let's say you do actually cut off people's legs, right? Unless there are people from the place where you cut off their legs in the other town where you are, who knows? How does that track you? You know, like, nobody can just, you know, it's not like it would be cheap and easy to call your friend, you know, or Snapchat them. Or post it on the, you know.
Well, there's still lots of travelers around the world that are not circus performers that spread awful stories from town to town. Like, word spreads, and word has always spread. Like, we still had elections.
Not as fast.
No, not as fast, but it gets there. It doesn't have to get there quickly.
Lost legs to dwarves. Stop.
Yeah.
Arms too. Stop.
The infamous.
I'll tell you what, it's a fascinating concept that, like, I mean, who is that police officer that has to go investigate? Let's assume that there's a kernel of this is true, right? And there is a town of by and large peaceful performers that are there, and then all of a sudden there's some sort of brutal murder. Like, and you're the police officer that has to go into the unmarked woodland town to try and find justice for the people.
I could picture a cop walking up there and being like, there's a city full of dwarves there. And then he gets back to the bar later on. You're like, so what'd you do? He's like, are you kidding me?
Hashtag,
there's a city full of dwarves there. I beat the hell out.
Hashtag True Detective Season 2.
So one of my favorite, and I've mentioned this, you know, several times on this podcast, but one of my favorite stories is from a friend of mine and actually Justin's, Jack Latona.
Oh, yeah.
Talked about, I think he was on the city council in Fort Lauderdale, and one day he's in his office and they get a call from this woman, this old woman, and she says, their body's coming out of the ground. There are people coming out of the ground. I'm like, nobody's been doing nothing about it. Their body's coming out of the ground. And the secretary's like, what do we do? This sounds crazy. Jack's like, yeah, it sounds crazy, but you never know.
I am the city councilman in Fort Lauderdale. We should probably investigate it.
Yeah. Well, she called everybody. Nobody listened to him.
Yeah.
You know? And so she was just trying. She was complaining and saying this. He says, all right, why don't we, you know, have a, you know, police car or something go by there. They send a police car by, and it's these basically these old buildings, like these project-type buildings, and it's very low-income area. And they go look in the back area and the overgrown grass area, and they start looking along, and sure enough, there are skeletons and bodies half coming out of the ground. It had been a pauper cemetery where they hadn't actually put them in coffins. They just threw them in the ground, and as the rain came in and the mud drained away, the bodies were coming out of the ground.
Good God. That's horrifying.
Yeah. And you think, here's this woman. It's like, hey, listen, there are bodies coming out of the ground.
Yeah.
Could you please describe more fully the situation?
Yeah.
There's bodies coming out of the ground.
you know, like, really, could you help us out here, please?
This yeah, there's bodies coming out of the ground.
Now, and meanwhile, if it were somebody who is absolutely, you know, like a gunfighter calm and calling there in the most erudite British accent, it would still most accurately be, there are bodies coming out of the ground.
There are dwarves cutting off legs.
So you never know. So I think we'll get maybe some of our Wisconsinites out there will go investigate this for us and let us know. And
be rad. Good luck with your legs.
Yeah. Well, you know, maybe pair up. Yeah. Know, wear stilts. Go out exactly. there in stilts. So it'd be
shin guards. Tall, and like, shin guards and knee pads. Come on. Let's stay safe,
stilts,
people.
They'll be like, oh, they'll cut off the stilts or not. You know,
maybe get some practice in by going to a playground at recess time and beating up as many kids as you can at once.
That seems like a really responsible way to handle this.
Yeah, be prepared.
All right. So, gentlemen, do we want to do one more?
Sure, go ahead.
All right. This is kind of cool. This is more of a technology thing, which is kind of a cool thing, which I thought. And it's a ongoing Microsoft project. Oh, actually, you know what? I think I want to do. I just forgot. Let me do that, and then we'll talk about. There's so many other things I want to get to. All right. I'm going to do this first. Forget I said that, okay?
Okay.
Forget I brought that up because this is the thing I want to talk about. This was a cool thing that came out on IO9 today explaining one of the reasons why we really want to investigate the moon Europa, right?
Which is what we've talked about before. We spent a lot of time talking about it on this podcast, right?
Europa?
Europa. What wasn't that the idea of...
Yeah, the ice.
Yeah, the ice and underwater civilization, how you would keep records underwater.
Yeah, we touched upon that. So Europa's a moon of Jupiter. But the thing that made it particularly interesting for me, which sold it for me, was an infographic which explained that Europa has more water than Earth does.
What?
Europa has more water than Earth does.
What? Because it's all frozen, though, right? Or I guess...
Well, can't be frozen, Brett, to the core. What do you know?
Yeah.
So we know that there is likely, like just large swaths of ice, but we have no idea how deep those reservoirs go and how much water there is.
Yeah, how do you calculate that?
There are fissures on the surface of it that look where the ice is broken through and then liquid waters come through the top and then refroze. So there is very likely, at some stages, there's liquid. There's very likely a liquid ocean underneath the ice of Europa.
Hmm.
So
how big is Europa relative to Earth?
What's that?
How big is Europa relative to Earth?
Europa is, I think, you know, smaller than the moon. Or is it? No, is it bigger than the moon? Let's see how big Europa is. Good question. Europa to moon. I'm going to go to Wolfram Alpha and do that. Entertain yourselves.
Mooncat suggests that Europa is about the same size as the moon. And to have more water than Earth, then like by percentage, I wonder... You know, how much of that, you know, just land mass as a whole is completely, reservoirs and submerged. I mean, I guess that's the crazy of all we know of it is ice. Then we have no idea how deep that ice runs and in what patterns. And like if even the way that, well, I guess we know enough about how planets are made to kind of know generally how it's constructed. Right.
Does it have to have a solid core? Well, I mean. Clearly, it doesn't have to have a solid core, but like, how deep is it possible for water to go before it can't just be a giant drop of water floating in space?
Sure.
No, it could certainly have a core because there are certainly going to be materials and things like that, the heavier elements and stuff that would be there. So it's not. We're pretty sure it's not solid water because I think that we'd be able to figure out the mass from that and what it would expect it to weigh versus the size, but. You know, if you look at the Earth and how thin, you know, Europa certainly wouldn't be solid water all the way through. If you look at the Earth and then like how, you know, like they had the example, like, oh, if the Earth was a basketball, the water on the surface of it would be, I don't know how thick, but they use sort of those examples. But anyhow, it's a fascinating thing to think about that the biggest ocean in our solar system is not our ocean. It's on Europa.
Wow.
Hmm.
So then... How far are we away if we add up all the timeline projections of the technology from being able to mine Europa for water if we wanted to?
Well, there are a lot of easier places to get your, you know, water. You know, the asteroid Ceres has water on it.
Yeah.
And so if you start looking at other places there that have even less gravity, there are other places. But the curious thing we want to do is we want to be able to land a probe, drill through the ice, and go see what's in the ocean there.
What's going on there, yeah.
Because there's some scientists who think that, like, we might, you know, it might be you drill through the ice, you pop through there, and some little thing looks right back at you.
Yeah. That is wild.
That's super crazy.
So.
Especially if we piss it off and it tried to cloak itself with ice, and now it's just an angry jellyfish creature with a rocket.
So would Europa be a colonization point? Like, I mean, is it something that we could look to, like, is the availability of water there make it more likely to be habitable than something like Mars, where we would have to import it?
No, we don't have to import water to Mars. Mars has water.
Oh, Mars has water. Okay, never mind.
Yeah, Mars has, like, I forget the percentage, but, like, one you know, cubic foot of dirt on Mars has, like, 1% or 2% of water.
Okay, okay.
Which is, yeah, that's Mars, like, these other places, like, keep looking more and more attractive now because of the prevalence of water. We used to think, you know, back when I was a kid, there was the point where you looked at, you know, the, you know, where, what makes Earth special? Like, we got this water and we don't see water anywhere else. And then now we look like, holy crap, there's a lot of water
out there. There's water everywhere.
There's more water, like, more water on Europa than on here.
Yeah.
Turns out hydrogen and oxygen are kind of common.
Who would have thought?
Kaya was pointing out, and yes, I am a big fat idiot. Every place we have been has water, which, I mean, at this point, like, in terms of the grand list of space explorations, it's, you know, not that many places that we've been that has water. I mean, I guess in terms of probes and everything.
But as to, I mean, you know, you'd try to colonize Mars. I'm a big believer that we just, you know, why not live on asteroids? But then when it comes to Europa, you would build, you know, that might become like Antarctica, building research stations and trying to study what's underneath, et cetera. And yeah, it's pointed out there in the chat room. Somebody pointed out there's a thing on the movie out Europa Report, which Brian talked about. It's a found footage film, so it'll take me a while to get through it.
We will get through it. It just, you know, it's going to take a little time.
So anyhow, that's just think about it. The more water on Europa than Earth, the biggest ocean in our solar system we know of, ain't on Earth.
That is buck crazy. Wild. And so when did that come out? How do they figure that out?
How do they?
Or is that just a known?
Well, I mean, no. I mean, it's as we send probes by, we look at the surface. We are able to analyze what it is, its mass, et cetera.
What's the atmosphere of Europa like?
Somebody in the chat room said there's no water on the moon. That's not correct. There is water on the moon, too.
And Whitey's on the moon.
Yeah. So there's, like, water everywhere. And you know what? It's very cool. Here's the thing to think about. There is actually probably ice and snow on Mercury.
Whoa.
What?
You're like, Andrew, that's insane.
It's so close to the sun.
But the thing is that Mercury is essentially, you know, what you call, like it has its, the way that it moves around the sun, there's craters and there's parts of it that do not see sunlight. And it's like in the shadows of those craters, et cetera, it gets dramatically cold. And you would have ice form.
That's insane.
So could we build cliff dwellings like halfway up that crater to moderate temperature?
If we would like to live on Mercury, which seems like a fairly poor idea.
Hey, it's possible, right? I mean, it's a poor idea to live anywhere that isn't Earth after we've spent billions of years being perfectly suited to this one planet.
Especially with these home prices, am I right?
When I was a kid, I remember picking up this book about colonizing space, and this is, you know, written in the 70s, and it was beautifully illustrated. It was probably by somebody who was very high at the time. And one of the cool places we could live on, they described, was what about on a sunspot? And they actually had this colony, like, on a sunspot, right? And you saw the really, really hot sun all around, but then the sunspot looked like San Diego, you know, people paragliding and stuff. And as a kid, I'm like, this doesn't seem like a really good idea for a lot of reasons. And one, a sunspot's actually still, like, a couple million degrees, probably one. You know, because you're still, guess what, next to the goddamn sun.
Yeah. There is that part about being on the sun, you know.
Yeah. And then there's, like, oh, the huge crushing gravity. You know, there's that too.
Pushing you into the flaming hell that is the sun.
And then we talk about the radiation. So
Yeah.
Dumb idea. It was a beautiful picture, though.
Oh, dude. Very high. Very high, brother.
Thing I mentioned before, I just touched upon, which is kind of cool, is Microsoft has revealed one of the concepts, some more stuff for an idea they have for how to maximize the space around your living room, for example. And they call it, we find the example of what they describe it as here. Basically what it is, it's a projection system that would project images onto the walls around your TV, everywhere else. And they showed a concept of this where they were using it to project, let's say, the internet. So you could be sitting there watching television and then look up and see, they call it surround web, Microsoft's plan to cloak your living room with internet. And they show, like, you know, somebody's playing, looks like Forza Motorsport or whatever. And then above it is their TV, above their TV projected on the wall are some stats, to the left, some video and everything else. And it's an interesting idea we've talked about before, you know, turning everything else into some sort of surface, some sort of display.
Yeah. Now, in the past, it seems like you've been not exactly bullish on the projection idea, though, right? Like that there would be other ways that we could you know, do stuff that wasn't a projection necessarily.
Well, I'm big on projection. I think that the next step is going to be as it becomes easier to, you know, project large amounts of light and keep things cool as we get cooler LEDs, et cetera. I think that you're going to see, and it becomes dirt cheap, is you're going to see devices that are the size of Apple TVs or whatever that are projectors, and you just start projecting your images instead of buying big flat screens.
Yeah.
And as you start projecting, and like what Microsoft's doing here is saying, hey, let's look at a room, look at all the flat spaces, and project onto there.
That's what we do at my house already, and it's great. Like, we in the living room just have an 8-foot whiteboard and a projector mount on the ceiling, and it frees up so much space. Granted, we like don't get to watch cable TV or anything, but we can still stream like Hulu and Netflix and stuff on it. And the rest of the time, it's a awesome whiteboard that ideas get to go on.
That's very cool. See, Brett's living in the future, guys. That's why he's here. Yeah. But you start thinking about you when you have enough projector where you could project onto any surface.
Yeah.
In your place. And I think
any light colored surface at that point, like your design styles are being dictated by whether or not you want to use a wall as a projector or a projection screen.
Yeah. But you could start projecting everything. And I think that one of the things that we talked about before, eventually you get to just like straight projecting right into the eyeball. But
yeah.
The intermediary technology is really cheap video projectors and projecting all around. And so their idea is that like the image quality isn't as good as looking at your TV, your blacks aren't true blacks, et cetera. But for other kinds of bits of data, like following your Twitter stream. I mean, this looks like a nightmare to me. I'll be honest. You know, watching TV and having all this other data pop up. It might be fun for a video game, but I don't really want to watch Game of Thrones.
Yes.
Yeah. No. And that's it's funny because I thought about that a lot when I was using Google Glass. That like, all right, now let's look at the idea that there is a small projection system that I can have in my face at all times. The next step, and I don't think this is necessarily a fault to Google Glass, it just happens to be the first widely publicly available version of this that has gained a degree of popularity. What is the information that we want there? And I think like this is a very good example. What do we, I mean, like, what would be more popular? Live updating tech stuff, the way that we look at the internet on our laptops and on our phones and on our iPads, or just a updating wallpaper that just kind of looked good and you enjoyed and made you happy when you looked at it. I think that there's an infinite amount of information that we can project there, and it's not the ultimate stopping place for that will not be what we think of the internet as, like the news gathering element.
Yeah, I would love to do this podcast with video projection and sit on my couch and talk to you guys.
Yeah.
And I think we start looking at what The smartphone showed us what we could pull away from the internet and put into our pocket. The tablet said, what can we pull away from our computer and, you know, our laptops and put in front of us? And then as we try to pull everything away from the desktop into other places, and that doesn't mean necessarily turning the TV into your computer. It can mean looking at other areas, other ways of using these technologies.
That's a good way to look at it. I mean, the first step to like internet content was putting the TV on your desktop, but that is not a place you want to absorb TV from.
No.
And we do need a better way to move away from that.
Sure. That's did fascinating.
Speaking of which, and maybe you guys saw this, you know, for our listeners out there, made up for the Oculus Rift is a new technology, or it's a new way approach towards trying to make a much better 3D type of goggle. And the problem that's been in the past for having strapping on goggles and seeing 3D is resolution's been crappy, field of view's been very small, and tracking was bad. And that's why if you played some of these things, they were too slow to track and it just didn't feel really good. And as we've had smartphones have evolved, and now you have smartphone screens with approaching 4K displays, and you have on a chip sensors can track your head better, and we're getting much faster computing. The 3D goggles, the strapping them on and being in virtual reality has gotten much, much better. And Oculus Rift is one of the companies leading the way in developing really, really cool high-end 3D. And you guys heard about the demo that was done at South By?
Yeah, it was actually the line was wrapping around the block, literally half a block away from the Diamond Club party yesterday. It was a huge, huge line for the demo, and we were trying to get the party set up. But otherwise, I would have waited in line. I don't know if it was badge only, but we saw everybody waiting in line for it.
I didn't hear about how it went, though.
You think about what would be really cool. You already have this technology, and right now what it's good for is you can strap these things on. One of the demos they have people say is great. You can see a movie theater, and it feels like you're in a giant movie theater. Again, you just put these goggles on, but you feel like you're in a big, huge cavernous theater. Another example is, you know, what could you do? They have demos where you step into rooms, you step into there. Well, HBO and Game of Thrones came along and said, hey, this sounds like a fun thing. And so, Justin, do you know the walkthrough on what happens?
I do not. I heard, Game of Thrones is obviously a very popular thing with the nerd set that is right now taking over Austin. And between this and the Game of Thrones rap mixtape, which was released on Friday, HBO is clearly gearing up as True Detective comes to an end. They are gearing up for the impending Game of Thrones scene.
But do you know what they did with the Oculus?
No, Rift? I do not.
Okay. Apparently what you do is you go step into the elevator in the Great Wall, the wall that separates, you know, the North.
Uh-huh.
You get into the elevator, you put on the goggles, and it simulates that you're taking the elevator to the top of the wall, and then it opens up and you look out onto the wall and you can see the vast snowy landscapes. And they apparently have wind blowing at you and they make it cold and they add all this other sensory information so you feel like you're looking at the frontier.
Oh, crazy. I wonder how many people try to pee off it, like Tyrion.
I was at the Launch Festival a couple of weeks ago, and they had like this this omnidirectional treadmill that you stand in the middle of with some goggles on, and then you can walk in any direction, and it tracks your body movement and moves you through the video game that you're playing without you moving anywhere.
I think
it was
a Skyrim mod. Yeah, I think I remember seeing a thing with that.
Yeah, it was a shooter.
Oh, was it a shooter? Okay. Yeah. I know that there is a Skyrim mod for that same system. That is crazy, though. So, I mean, like, have you read... I haven't read any of the reviews. Have people been positive on it?
Oh, yeah. They say this experience was great. That part of what helped it was adding these other effects to it.
Yeah.
It's a very, very stunning... It's one of the most stunning demonstrations of it yet. And this is... You know, we're... not going to see we're not going to see the ideal version of this probably in production this year, but probably by next year, somebody like Sony and other companies are working on it. We're very, very soon going to be seeing the next big thing is going to be these 3D goggles. They're going to be the really good ones with really good tracking. There'll be some crappy ones out there that people will try to race to market with that won't track as well. And that might kill some of the enthusiasm, but when the really good next gen ones come out that are like that you put on, you don't get nauseous and are super, super realistic, that's going to be the next big, you know, innovation in hardware.
So you are bullish on VR because VR has been a field that a lot of people have been bullish on for a lot of years, and it has always kind of been the thing that is barely out of reach, not very out of reach.
You have the thing is that like in technology, you sometimes need certain things to fall in place for the next thing to happen. And you know, I had a Nintendo Virtual Boy back in the 90s.
I rented one,
and I was always fascinated with this. But the problem you had before is you had your three biggest problems were one, resolution. How quality of a screen can you put in front of your eyes? And when you're this close to an image, you know, I'm just holding my fingers out there, you're going to see the resolution lines. You're going to feel like you're looking at video.
Yeah.
That's problem number one. Problem number two is going to come down to speed. How fast can you update it you know, send that signal through there and keep that thing going. How fast can you update? If you move your head to the left or the right, can you keep that signal? The third problem comes into tracking. How do you track where the head is moving? Now, you know, every average smartphone device has a super high resolution screen.
Yeah.
It's got motion sensors inside of it that are very, very good at tracking, and it's got a super fast processor. So
let's say that those are the three biggest problems, though we don't necessarily know that those are the only three big problems, though. I think the real test is like how important those added sensory perceptions are to the experience. Like if it turns out that we're looking out through a fake window, and that might not even be compelling, even if it's perfect.
Well, I guess, Brett, I'm talking about in comparison to like video games as they are. Why would you want to strap this on your head to go play Halo versus sit in front of your computer and play Halo?
Yeah.
Right.
And, you know, the computer is the better experience because of you don't have the lag time, those other issues. Once you say, okay, we satisfy that, for many people, this becomes a more attractive way to play that.
Especially if it gives you greater control of the game, which is where you see the divide between PC gaming and console gaming. If all things are equal, people just prefer the idea of a keyboard and a mouse to a control pad.
Well, that's interesting, because
when does this become a superior form of entertainment to other forms of entertainment? That's a good question. You know, do you want to watch movies like this? You know, does it have to go to a next level and have the other experiences you talked about? That I don't know.
I think the interesting thing about that is that the reason people play the games on the PC still is because it doesn't mirror the world or model the world at all. You can do things that you wouldn't be able to do in the real world. And that same analog we see with each new iteration of like input controls for computers. We went from a keyboard to a mouse. The mouse is not more efficient than keystrokes. If you're trying to do things quickly, you're going to go back to learning keystrokes. And the same goes with like voice controls now. Like, yeah, you can use Siri, but 9 times out of 10, you can do it faster some other way.
You're talking about input methods versus how you, you know, output. And
we're always trying
to increase frame rate. We're always trying to increase the size of displays. We're always driving towards that. When we do, you know, first person shooters and you move around, you track around, we're always trying to improve all of those aspects to it.
Right. But if you're using the goggles to track around, then the goggle is an input method. And is that a better input method than being able to
That's the still big question is what are you going to use for an input? Maybe you still have a controller in your hand. Maybe you put a gun in your hand. Maybe you use some sort of leap motion or Kinect type thing to see what you do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe we put you on the treadmill. And I think that when you have the really good VR just in itself, the really good, you feel like you're sipping inside of a movie theater, that is going to be a big step.
Yeah. I mean, it'll definitely be a big, interesting step. I'm curious to see whether or not it actually like pays off as a mass market thing.
Well, I mean, if you look at, I mean, where consoles are now, it's hard to get really bullish about where the console market is going to be over the next 10 years. I mean, there's a reason why they're all trying to build in, you know, TiVos and cable, pass-through options and stuff like that. And it's because they think that that's where they will survive instead of just people buying video games on there and playing them. If that's the case, and games themselves are only becoming more popular as they are put in more and more people's hands, and we have a collective global freakout over things like Flappy Birds not being around anymore, who's to say that a new super compelling way to interact with them will not be the next big thing? My only hesitation is via, you know, that idea, the idea of a virtual reality experience as one that is, you know, like, if not haunted, fraught with peril.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
that's what you agreed with, that it's probably haunted and fraught with peril. We just agreed that Lawnmower Man is the biggest threat to VR.
I think that, like, you know, like, they're trying to make a good electric car. You couldn't make a good electric car until you solved a couple market problems. You know, one, don't try to make a cheap one, address the sports market, and two, you know, laptop batteries, you know, the battery problem. That was the biggest problem. You couldn't make a car that go anywhere because you couldn't have a battery that was efficient enough. But billions of dollars spent on cell phones and laptops later, you know, now the market price for these batteries was, you know, one, they're available, and two, cheap enough that you could put make an electric car. And, you know, these are the you need certain technological advancements driven by other markets, and I think we're in a position where that's happened.
Well, that's a good analog too, because I feel like for me to want to own VR goggles or for it to be mass market at all, it has to be so cheap that it's the kind of thing that you might use. It has to be power glove level. We're like, all right, well, I have this thing sitting around here and maybe I'll use it once in a while.
Yeah, well, but it has to be
that price point, not that usage level necessarily.
You said use two cap for you to want it or for it to be or mass market. I don't own a game console. I don't own a game console that was made in the last 6 years.
Right.
You know,
near do
so
I.
I don't, you know, I wouldn't describe
aside from your iPhone.
Just mass market. What's that?
I said, aside from your iPhone.
Yeah. Which is not a, you know,
yeah.
which I would say is a game console, but yeah, I think that that's, you know, as far as, but what can be big, but you look at the success of a game like Minecraft. And then you start thinking when you have a different kind of interaction taking place with games or narratives. So
it will be interesting to see, because that would be dope if it's great. I think there's a reason why we want it all to happen.
Yeah.
And the desire for it has caused so many false starts.
And we've known for a while the biggest problems was kind of resolution and latency, and those are things that are being directly addressed. And that's going to be the interesting thing to see what happens. And the cost effectiveness of these things is, you know, these panels are a lot cheaper. And, you know, you look at what you look at the high tech stuff coming on a Kickstarter.
Yeah.
Which is pretty amazing. What people are able to go build there. So anyhow, let's move to picks.
Yes.
Now's the time where we pick things. Who shall go
mostly for? My nose.
Do you have any on the top of your head? Or
yeah,
do you
well,
to go
right
then...
now I'm reading or listening to Ghostwritten by David Mitchell. Have you guys checked that out yet?
No, what is it?
So the guy that wrote Cloud Atlas, which I was very fond of. This is Ghostwritten, an earlier work that is along the same lines. It has a lot of different like plot lines that I assume intermix eventually. But the first storyline is all about this guy who is part of a like a doomsday cult, kind of. But he is so deep in it that he doesn't realize he's part of a doomsday cult. He's very sold on the concept that he's the only one living the righteous life.
Mm-hmm.
And that alone was a very compelling plot line, just to hear someone trying to explain to the rest of the world why his way is better and he should be allowed to murder people.
Hmm. Awesome. I never read Cloud Atlas, but you were a huge fan of that.
A big fan of the audiobook especially was really well done, because it's six different characters with six different storylines, and so they use six different narrators because it's all
that's
in the
great.
First person.
I love it when they do that.
Yeah, and this actually that is an important point about this version of the book is they have a British narrator, but the main characters are all Japanese, and that was a very weird disconnect for a long time.
Are they doing the Japanese voice, or is it
no,
all British
no,
voice?
No, it's all like, I have a very good idea. And you're like, I don't think the Japanese say idea.
I speak as my father spoke in Tokyo. Andrew, what are you looking at?
All right, me? Fine. All right. My pick is, I just saw this last night, and I enjoyed it, and that is Hotel of Budapest.
The Grand Budapest Hotel?
Grand Budapest Hotel. I kept thinking of the exotic Marigold Hotel. I can't get that out of my head. Grand Budapest Hotel, as it's better known as.
I can't wait to check that out. Were there any high points that are spoiler-free?
I think that it's one of the things. Okay, I'll tell you about this. Like, I have my favorite Wes Anderson films, you know, and this is... I like this a lot. It's not up there. It's not, you know, not a, you know, it's a very, very good. Ralph Fiennes is fantastic.
What are your top two?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Give us your top two, because that can be a little bit divisive, even amongst Wes Anderson fans on what the champ is.
So, but if I do that, I'm only going to divide things even more.
Well, but just so people
have
a sense of
okay,
where you're
like,
at.
I would say that, like, I love, like, there's always going to be a place in my heart for Tannenbaums, always going to be a place in my heart for Rushmore. And Life Aquatic is one of those things that I don't think I've watched that movie enough.
Wow, that might actually be my least favorite Wes Anderson movie.
Life Aquatic? Yeah, that's not high mind. But
did you see how I qualified that?
You did.
It's great. It is divisive.
Like, there's things I like.
I don't fault you for liking the movie.
There's like I think there might be more to it, but anyhow. That's my point. It's like, so that's the thing. Like, there's a lot I like about it, but I don't know. Oh, yeah. Moonrise Kingdom. I love
that
love,
is
love,
my
Moonrise
favorite,
Kingdom.
I think.
What's that?
I think that's my favorite of the Wes
Anderson movies. Yeah, that may be my favorite too. I mean, that is, I think that is just absolute pure joy all the way through. I think it's probably Moonrise Kingdom. But anyhow, but I said these things are complicated things.
A little lingering on the shots of the girl.
Yeah.
In Moonrise.
But so I thought Ralph Fiennes is fantastic. What happens in this movie, the problem in this movie though is you see some of your beloved people who actors and who've been in other movies by him or people in general, they're there and then they're not there and then you don't get them again.
Oh.
You know, or there's not a resolution or something to it in some respects.
In a way that you feel if you were remaking it as Wes Anderson, would you, you personally, I guess not as Wes Anderson, would you prefer to cast an unknown in those roles?
No, I just think that I would have had maybe not had those roles existed.
Yeah. Oh, interesting.
Or another scene or two with them to
give. But you kind of have to go one way or another. And especially because some of these people are beloved amongst the Wes Anderson universe. It's hard to, and I haven't seen the movie. I have no idea, but it would be hard if Bill Murray shows up for one scene and then his storyline is left hanging, even though he's made this impression.
Yes.
Okay.
That's good. I can't wait to see it.
Because part of it's like when you watch the trailers for like, oh, this will be great. This will be great. And then you like, oh, I saw all of that. You know, that person's.
Yeah.
But it's a great movie, though. Again, Ralph Fiennes is fantastic. This character's great. It's very, very much worth seeing. So that's my pick.
Oh, man.
The Motel Budapest.
The Motel Exotic Mary Pest in 3D. I have a bit of a different pick. I've been talking a lot, both with Brett and a few other people, about nonfiction, both books and films and documentaries. And it kind of started when I watched a film that was very, very popular. It was on Netflix called Blackfish. Now, Blackfish is a movie about the killer whales at SeaWorld. And it is safe to say I have never seen anybody go as hard against SeaWorld as this movie does. It is a absolute hit piece on SeaWorld.
Harder against SeaWorld than the average 13-year-old's Floridian boy?
Yes, I think so. I mean, I guess here's my point. I think that they cut a lot of corners, and I think the movie was something other than what it really, really wanted to be, which was they don't agree with animals being in captivity. That the makers of the film and the premise that they go through is one that informs their belief that they do not want animals not in the wild. And that to put them in display for humanity's benefit, even if it's entertainment or scientifically, is cruel and unusual toward the animals. And I think if that's their opinion, that's their opinion. But they created this whole other narrative that, by objective fact-checking, is a bit spotty, and maybe they went through things that were a little bit misleading to kind of get them there because they wanted to tell this other thing with the underlying point being maybe we shouldn't have animals in zoos or at SeaWorld at all. And it really made me think about where is the acceptable line for people, because I think we all three of us enjoy nonfiction programming of both books and documentaries and stuff like that. Where is the line for us in terms of you've told a great narrative, I've enjoyed that story, but you have shaved off too much of the facts that it is now a funhouse mirror distortion of what we can generally assume really happened? Like, what is that line for you?
I've moved away from, groups or movements that I support when I see that a lot of the people in them embrace polemics and things that are not as fact-based and shave those corners, because that frustrates me. Because if you can't find truth in your own position, you're not qualified to point out the failures in others. And that's a thing that bothers me considerably. And I have a lot of problem with documentaries, because a lot of times people are like, oh, you should see this documentary. And it's like, and I get frustrated because it's like, first 5 minutes in, they did these three things, which, maybe the overall theme I agree with, but these three things are distorting it, and they're, like you said, using the term shaving things off, and it frustrates me. I almost sent you a thing today, an LA Times piece about this researcher who studies, you know, ignorance. And then they give these examples of how people perpetuate ignorance. And it was the most politically agenda-based article, you know, you could imagine, because of all the assumptions they made. Like, well, of course these people are wrong. And of course these people are wrong. And it's because these people are trying to feed this ignorance. And it's like, wow, check your own biases.
Yeah.
So it drives me nuts.
But there is, part of it is stakes, right? Like, if, you know, there have been, I think, legitimate criticisms of people, of some of my favorite nonfiction writers to read, including in what we were talking about earlier this weekend, like Malcolm Gladwell and Michael Lewis, that they are people that, you know, can mold facts to fit a narrative that they have. And yet it doesn't tremendously bother me when he's, you know, when Michael Lewis in Moneyball kind of ignores the fact that the Oakland A's had an amazing, if not legendary, pitching staff, which was a lot of the reason why they were good, and not necessarily the bargain basement first baseman that they were able to find. So it doesn't really bother me all that much. There are other things of value that I can take from it. When I watch the King of Kong, by the available facts, shows that there was a lot of that movie that is brilliant and amazing to watch and super fun that did not happen chronologically, that they changed things to make them more dramatic so the movie itself can be more enjoyable. And that doesn't really bother me, because again, we are talking about a King Kong video game record. So I think part of it is it maybe the things that we hold dear, that line is tougher for us to deal with?
I think that it's in the things we tend to hold dear often can be our opinions and our views on the world. And that certainly is very, very frustrating. And it's a, you know, anytime somebody suggests a documentary to me, you know, it is frustrating, because it's just this, you know, the reason that you're so impassioned by this is because it appealed to you emotionally, not because it appealed to you rationally. Mm-hmm. It used emotion to make you think that these certain things are true, and some of which may be, but ultimately you're recommending it because you were moved on an emotional level, not a logical level.
Well, I would recommend people seeing Blackfish if even just to watch it for the idea of, watch it from the creator's perspective. And for me, I found it very interesting, understanding that it was a movie that was fraught with a lot of criticism, including, I think if you just search Blackfish on Google, SeaWorld's sponsored rebuttal, which is a fairly comprehensive minute-by-minute look at what they believe to be, and I think make a fairly compelling case as distortions in the film, pops up there. Just understand from a creator's perspective, you know, what is there? What do you believe? And what do you, what are statements that are made that are not untrue and yet not exactly what you might be led to believe?
Well, I would think that, I mean, that's a great point, is that I think that it's, the responsible thing for a thinking person to do when you watch something like this and it moves you and you want to tell people about, go look at the criticisms and the rebuttals. If you go tell other people, check this out without having looked at it, you're not being responsible. And that's a very frustrating thing, is that somebody says, oh, did you see this? And you go, did you see the counterpoint? And maybe the counterpoint was invalidated, but they get this no. And it's like, you only know one side of it. And the documentary does this idea of pretending to show you both sides or all the facts, but they don't. And there are things that I love and I support, but I'm like, go look at this, then go look at the criticism of this.
Yeah. And how about this? How about a documentary on SeaWorld sucks and it's boring? And I always used to hate having to go there instead of a real theme park in Orlando.
Directed by a 13-year-old boy from Florida.
It's a 31-year-old boy from Florida.
Would you remember, was it Ocean World?
Ocean World. Where was Ocean World?
That was in Fort Lauderdale. That's where the Art Institute campus is now.
Oh, really? Yeah. No. I was always more the Seaquarium was the only one that was really.
So they had, when I was, they had Ocean World there, right? And like then when they closed down, Ocean World was really sad and broken down. It was busted up. And then when they cleared out Ocean World, the developers go and then they start digging up the ground and they start finding dolphin bodies and all these.
Oh my God!
Like, wow, they seem to have lost quite a few.
The dolphins are coming out of the ground.
Oh, yes. I mean, they didn't have a shark tank. They would just dice them up and fed them to them.
I'll tell you what. I kind of feel like if the documentary was just animals shouldn't be in zoos, then, like, okay, fine. Like, I can get somebody saying that. Like, that is a point of view that I don't think is necessarily invalid. I don't really know enough to have a point of view on it. But, like, I feel like that was – but what frustrated me more than anything was just – say what you mean, man. Like, just say what you mean. Yeah. You mean that you hate animals in zoos, and you mean that it really bothers you that these animals are in SeaWorld at all. And it's not necessarily that this, you know, that you're trying to demonstrate negligence on the part of SeaWorld. Your biggest sin in their biggest sin in your eyes is that they exist at all. And if that's your point, then just make that point. And also, it is very beneficial to look at exactly what people say and exactly what is insinuating and exactly what they have attempted to prove, as we have learned today by reading the cover story of Newsweek.
It seems like that goes right back to the polemics that Andrew doesn't like. It's like that was the point they wanted to make in the film, and they couldn't make their own point, so they found a story that like closely mirrors that point.
Well, and you can't sell that point. Selling the animal shouldn't be in zoos point to CNN is harder than selling the we have uncovered a pattern of corruption that has led to death. That's speaking, you know, that is the speaking truth to power narrative that sells to CNN. The fact that you hate the fact that zoos exist does not qualify as newsworthy.
There you have it. Last minute housekeeping. When this goes up out on weirdthings.com and Justin tweets it and I tweet it and Brit tweets it, we'd love for you guys to maybe tell your friends about Weird Things.
Absolutely. Go ahead. Let's make this week Tell Your Friends About Weird Things week. Go ahead.
This is actually by far my favorite podcast on the interwebs.
There we go. And you could be this episode. It could be your favorite episode ever. The beautiful thing about Weird Things is that by and large, it's an evergreen podcast. It's not really shackled to the stories of the day necessarily. So pick your favorite one and tell a friend about it on Twitter. Make sure you include @WeirdThingsCom in there. And maybe we'll shout out some of the folks that did that next week.
Yeah. And maybe I just want to check something here. I realize... I want to look something up here. I'm doing my research. I'm not haunchy research as much as I'd like to be doing. And I would, seriously, if anybody out there, and I understand that is a swamp, but if anybody out there wants to go out there and go look for said haunchies, we'd love to find out. We take no responsibility of that.
In fact, we're going to have you sign a waiver.
Yeah, we can't be accountable for that. So I believe, again, can't get through a Weird Things episode without mentioning... You know what? Next Sunday, I think, is the launch.
Mm-hmm.
March 16th, I think, is SpaceX is going to be launching their Dragon for the ISS resupply mission. And this is going to be the Dragon, or the Falcon rocket, rather. The Falcon is going to have landing legs on it.
Yeah. But they're not using it, right? They're
just are, just to land in the ocean.
Yeah, they're going to try to pick a point. They're going to pick a point in the ocean and try to hit it at the kind of velocity that they would need to land. Which is going to be super awesome. And it's really sad that they're not going to lead private space exploration, or private entities won't be leading space exploration in the future. Also, watch Cosmos on Fox.
Yeah, unrelated. But yeah, so maybe I'll check the time so that maybe we do a Weird Things, a live cast.
I'd love to. I'd love to do that. That would be super fun. And I think maybe we could even rope in. I remember we did the launch thing with Merritt last time. I'm sure Merritt would love to maybe bitch in and help us with that. We could have Brian run CENTCOM here, and we can do some dope coverage. That'd be great.
Yeah, again, a rocket designed to land back on the pad, kids.
It's amazing.
Freak show. Absolutely.
That's a game changer. That's a Kitty Hawk moment.
All right. I'm not going to say all the snipey things that I would have otherwise said. It's, you know, it's fine.
I'll say it's been weird, which I just did, and then now we can say the snipey things.
Neil deGrasse Tyson is a reactionary, and I feel like for whatever reason,
very negative person.
He is ignoring facts, scientific facts, for which he rightfully criticizes a lot of people about, for things that he is politically. I would say he rightfully criticizes a lot of people for kind of ignoring basic science facts, and it bothers me that he has a blind spot with this and cannot help engender excitement in space exploration and instead wants to take things down. And this is about his South by Southwest talk. And I'm going to stop the recording because I will accidentally leave this in. it bothers me that somebody who is very rightly so a advocate for science and space and getting people excited about it is more apt to talk about things we didn't do and things we aren't doing, as opposed to the things we are doing and the things we are excited about now in the fields that he cares a lot about.
In short, he's been dismissive of the private space efforts. And, you know, you bring up SpaceX and he says NASA's been doing that for 30 years and NASA ain't doing it now. And not for the fault of the people who work in there. It's the problem of a bureaucracy trapped by government pork barrel projects, et cetera, and all that. And it's, you know, I know sometimes we sound like we can be down on NASA and that's the opposite of our attitudes on stuff. It's just that the way things work, and we're in this wonderful, wonderful place right now where really, really rich people with money to spend can help and can invest in things with the idea of long shot returns. And the things they invest in are things like reusable spacecraft. And, Keo says that Neil is a dreamer. I think he's a very small dreamer. I think that we have dreamers like Elon Musk and other people who are saying, hey, well, let's take what we've done before and do it better. You know, NASA 30-year history did not build a rapidly reusable spacecraft. They did not build a spacecraft that was, you know, reusable. And that was partially not, and it was because of the way to get money to build things. NASA has to be able to go to government contractors and say that we'll buy these things. And the government contractors influence the senators to say, that's great. We'll, you know, we're going to spend $100 million, $200 million on a rocket. The last thing that the people selling them want is a reusable rocket, because that would drive the cost down. And so there are all these perverse incentives in place that make things complicated. And I think that, you know, it makes it hard to look through the real problem and see that what we really need is better technology and the better technologies.
And let's say, all right, he's a dreamer. That's rad. Do you crap on other dreams? Like, you know, is that, if he obviously doesn't agree with it, and that's fine, man. Like, but it seems weird that with the progress SpaceX has made, his opinion hasn't changed.
What bothers me about him isn't that he dresses down.
That's facts. Like, the fact is that these things are really exciting. And the fact is that if this reusable rocket is a thing, it's a fundamental game changer for what we can do in terms of space travel. And, like, it disappoints me that from somebody who rightfully gets so much respect is that the idea is not, hey, listen, I don't think it'll happen, but I'm very excited to see them try. And I'm very excited to see somebody put their money where their mouth is and try to innovate in this space.
And that's not a difficult thing to say. Like, people, like, what bothers me most about him isn't that he necessarily dresses down other people's dreams. It's that he made a personal brand around dressing down other people, period. Like, you don't see anything from him that isn't like, hey, idiot, you did the math wrong. And he may not use those words, but that's the sentiment behind pretty much every report that he puts out.
And more so, like, as we illustrated on a prior podcast, in A Case of Gravity, he was mostly wrong on that stuff. It was, well, you wouldn't likely do this, but you could do this.
Right.
And these got put forth as fact and repeated by people who, you know, wanted to, who thought that carrying the pitchforks and torches of science is the same thing as doing good science, which it's not. I was frustrated because the whole, like, well, NASA's been doing that. Well, they never developed, you know, a rocket that was that cost effective, you know, that efficient, and mainly because maybe it was never a mandate that served the purposes. And, you know, but it's like, no, they didn't do it. You know, they hadn't done it. And the things that are being done now is like the Morpheus lander that Mathis is testing out as this, like, this thing for landing on, let's say, Mars. Looks like it's a squat thing with rockets. It looks very capable, very, very cool. If I had never seen a 10-story tall grasshopper go 1,000 feet up in the air, go horizontal, and then land back on the pad, I'd be impressed with the Morpheus.
It's also weird because it's not like he's like, oh, Tesla, nice try making a car. Cadillac's been doing that for 100 years.
Yeah.
And that was, you know, there was a quote I read from Neil deGrasse Tyson about climate change and politics in science. And the gist of the quote, which I'm sure people will be able to find, was that I am not mixing politics with what I say. I'm only saying facts. The Earth is getting warmer. That's a fact. If you have a problem with it, it's because of your politics. And for whatever you have, whatever thoughts you have on global warming, whatever, like, if that is right now, there's never been a reusable rocket. Somebody is testing a reusable rocket. That's a fact. maybe the way that you are looking at it is because of, and I won't even go, I don't want to use the loaded term of politics, but rather just previous bias, you know, like, mm-hmm. like maybe you just, maybe it bothers me that there is no review of the thinking, no matter where you came from and what is in your past and what your previous ideas are. The beauty, I mean, what I love about the concept of critical thinking in science is that we are never sure. You know, like we have mm-hmm. we have what we accept and we go based on that information, but that our world can be turned upside down tomorrow, which is really so much of what this podcast is mm-hmm. like the idea of looking at the game changing moments, the moments, you know, a Mars goes invisible, because it's those things that are that prove why we need critical thinking and why we need science.
And what frustrates me too about the South By talk is he talked about, like, well, the frontiers have always been pushed by government efforts. He said, you know, we didn't, you know, he says it was, you know, the East Indian, the West Indy, the Dutch company didn't discover America, you know, Columbus backed by the Spanish government. And I'm like, well, actually, it was a bunch of privateering Vikings that made it here first. And then it was the Spanish crown, meaning the wealthiest person in Spain, i.e. the queen, who put her money into backing Columbus. And then if you look at in the last year, couple of years, the biggest, you know, who's gone to the deepest part of the ocean ever? Private individual, James Cameron.
Yeah.
In a submarine of his own design. You know, the ballooning record altitude heights were set by private individuals. There's just been a history of private individuals and enterprises pushing these boundaries, which doesn't make it any better or worse than, you know, government's done. And, you know, our biggest achievements we can say that we've done have often happened under the, you know, under the aegis of, you know, nationalism. You know, we only went to the moon because we wanted to beat the Russians. Once we beat the Russians, we're like, game over, done.
Yeah. It just seems so weird to fundamentally shoehorn our modern idea of government versus private enterprise into history, because right. I don't think that that has always been what it is now. And you know, for whatever it was in the past and whatever it is now, it kind of just leads to a misleading concept, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I think
we always, I mean, this has become like the new singularity in SpaceX is, you know, crapping on Neil deGrasse Tyson, but that really just bothered me.
I am super excited that he's bringing back Cosmos. Super, super excited.
This yeah, apparently is it's great. The reviews are great on it.
Yeah, and that we're getting this, you know, on prime time on Fox as well as on cable is great. The outreach for this is fantastic. You know. So somebody in the comments says, I think a possible effect, negative effect of SpaceX success would be further defunding of NASA. Well, I think that the problem is that how much money should we be spending in programs that are going to go nowhere in NASA versus spending money on really exciting programs like sending probes into Europa, et cetera, which I think NASA would be a prime candidate to do. If you have a viable alternatives to get stuff there, instead of spending billions of dollars on the SLS rocket system, which we're trying to launch and build now, which we're committing funds to do that we can't actually afford payloads on, if you spent no money on that, and then 20% of that on payload missions to Europa on SpaceX or whoever else, you'll get more science done. You'll get more things done. The goal isn't to defund it. The goal is to spend the money wisely.
Yeah. And to do more crap. Do more mm-hmm. crap easier. And you know how you do crap easier in government? Have a hard price tag that is there that won't necessarily balloon. You know?
Yeah, and have people competing for that business. You want SpaceX and is a big backer of SpaceX, love that, but we want other companies to get in there. And as that competes and you get a real market for it, NASA actually asked, had, you know, the whole SLS rocket system, NASA internally said, listen, why don't you let us maybe not build this and contract out to companies like SpaceX? But Congress said no, you have to build this rocket system. Right.
Which gets internally, into a whole...
they said, no, we don't want this. We would rather let SpaceX and those companies develop these systems on their own dime. And then we come in and pay a fair market value for use of this.
All right. Well, that's that. Dude, the next time that you are in Austin, Andrew, I want you to come up to Brian's chair and try to sit on it. It is the most uncomfortable chair. I have,
you know, it looks like he's on the edge of his seat.
He does. It is, because it's tilted forward, because it is always putting him in a better posture situation. He is always slightly tilted forward, but also you are like keeping yourself up on it at all times, and I need to get up and leave the studio because it is hurting my ass something awful. But that being said, I think this is a great episode, and I can't wait to get it out. And Brian will be back next week. It'll be a fun time.
Awesome.
Brett?
Sir, good to see you, man.
Good to see you.
I'll actually be back down in LA in a couple weeks.
That's nice.
All right. Well,
need a place bye-bye. To crash. Let me know.
All right. Thanks.
Homeless shelters downtown.
Yep. I prefer Union Station downtown LA. Nice. It's my favorite.
As I've I've shot there.
Mm, I've slept there.
Basically the same thing. All right, guys. I will. I'm shutting the stream down. Now.
Wait, we got a new listener.
Oh, Shaneros. Here. Thank you. Welcome. Welcome, Shaneros.
And bye-bye.
Yeah, we will have vids from South by Southwest up soon, including O'Shane. Well, sorry, man. Your nickname's Shaneros. Yeah, we'll have that up very, very soon. All right, guys. Bye.
Bye-bye.